the pick and roll. I like the give and go, cause it's basketball, but Mr. Kirch's flow.
Welcome, y'all, to the one-hour season opener, season premiere of Around the Rim. I am your host, the Dudster, Nestor Dudley, bringing in this 2009 season with Bradworth Benton, who's always representing.
Thank you, Nestor.
Welcome back to another year of the Mall Neighborhood Basketball League, the MNBL.
Yes,
and Brad, is that it's year 24, but what's that on your... What's that headpiece you got? Is that a wave cap? Well, it's not quite a wave cap.
It's not quite a wave cap, but I figured it's the 24th season of the league. I've been, you know, on this show for a long time now, and I just figured it's time.
This show was 17 years old.
Yes, so I figured it's time. I, you know, kind of go along with your flow. You know, I don't have quite that thing, but it's, you know, it's near a wave cap. It's close. It's like a sports cap.
Type thing.
Yeah. Plus, I didn't do my hair.
Oh.
So...
It's all good.
Yeah, it's good.
Brad, before we get on to this season, we have some business to clean up from last season. Not clean up, tie up from last season. So we just want to put the 2008-09 season to bed. And what we want to do is we want to announce the winners of the various contests from last year, starting with the Hot Shot Champion. So the Hot Shot Champion from a season ago, Brad, Bobby Bazdad, representing the Kings.
Yes, he stepped in and he took the place of another player who, you know, won it. You know, every coach does it different.
And I'm sure momentarily the slate will be up for the Hot Shot Champion.
Oh,
momentarily.
Well, you know, it should be up there, but I'll explain what happened. You know, every coach, you know, would have a little contest at their practice a week or two before the event's taking place, and usually one player will represent the Hot Shot and one will represent the three-point, and you give it to the commissioner, and he writes it down. And I believe last year, Sadi Anduha was actually the winner of the contest for the Kings, but he no-showed the event, and thank God Bobby Bedard was there, thanks to the coaches telling him to show up with his gear, his uniform. He showed up, listened to the coaches, came home with the victory. Nice trophy, nice good way to go out as a... You know, he was in the finals one year. He didn't make the playoffs the next year, but he comes home with a Hot Shot Champion.
Three-point champion, Bellen Daniel of the Pistons. And he was dropping threes like it was ice cream, Brad.
Yeah, he dropped quite a few. He broke the record last year, held by
Brian Resendez
of the Lakers.
Back in 1994.
Yep.
There was six in the game. And how many did he end up with in that game?
I think he ended up with nine.
Yes.
And he also broke the all-time record, I think, of in a season. So he's now the two-time champion for something, or the record holder, I should say. And he was dropping them all year, so it was apropos that he won the three-point contest.
Rookie of the Year, Sakiris Semeksent of the Bullets. And Brad, I have to tell you, we're not allowed to vote for Rookie of the Year, but
no.
We were given a mock ballot, and on my ballot, I gave it to his teammate, which was Jerome Dean.
I did the same thing. I voted for Jerome Dean. I didn't know you voted for him.
Well, you know, they give us mock ballots.
Yeah, well, you know, we just see who we think was going to win. Kind of like how the commissioner picks a winner of the championship every year, but never tells anyone.
So, if he picks a championship every year, we're talking about the commissioner,
yes,
and never tells anyone, then does he truly do this? I don't know. But in any case...
When I see him Saturday, I'm going to tell him... Actually, we're filming Sunday.
Yes.
When I see him Sunday, I'm going to tell him, put in an envelope, have all the coaches sign that envelope. At the end of the year, we want you to open it up at the banquet.
Nestor, are you questioning? This is Go Ref Go here. Welcome back to another season, by the way.
Go Ref Go! Happy New Year!
Happy New Year to you and to you too, Brad.
Mazel tov.
Nestor, are you questioning the commissioner?
I'm not questioning anything. Brad made a statement, and I just responded to the statement that Brad made. I'm not questioning anything.
So after the Rookie of the Year, who would we have? The MVP?
We have the League MVP.
League MVP
goes to... That was League MVP a year ago. The League MVP goes to Ricky Douglas of the
Actually, Sixers. No, that's correct. League MVP was Gui Osiris.
Oh, yeah, Gui Osiris, yeah. So it looks like that person.
Jumping slates.
Yes.
Jumping slates, yeah.
Yes. Gui Osiris, the leading scorer of the league, the leading scorer of the Sixers, the go-to man for the Sixers, he was your League MVP. And that would lead us to the playoff MVP.
The Mike Petrangelo Memorial Playoff MVP. I was getting confused with that. So that's Ricky Douglas' teammate.
Well, he was the MVP, so you weren't really wrong.
So I wasn't 100% correct either.
Yeah, but we look at it as you weren't wrong.
Okay.
So it is your show. We got to cover you. So we have Ricky Douglas with two S's. He came out with the league, the playoff MVP. Everyone thought Guy was going to do the double shot. But Ricky, you know, that championship game, it was because of him that they catapulted themselves to the win.
The Joseph A. Grossi Scholarship goes to Brian Horton, who started his career with the Kings, ended it with the Celtics.
2.5 seasons with the Kings, gets traded last minute, thought he had a shot at making the playoffs. The Kings knew they were pretty much out of it. Jumped to the Celtics, took home a scholarship. That was nice. He probably would have won it on the Kings too, but, you know, but he still didn't make the playoffs.
James Derlin Memorial Scholarship, and it's staying right here to Brian Horton.
Brian Horton, that was, you know, that's good for him. That's a couple scholarships. Save him some money. I heard his family has money.
James,
so it's just going to pile it right on top.
Once again, James Derlin played in this league for 2 years, I believe.
Two years.
He was on the 2001 championship
team. Yes, he was. 2000 and 2001 team. He played for 2 years. Drafted as a junior, played his senior year. His number has been retired. It is number 15. No one is allowed to wear that on the Kings. And, yeah, he was a former King, so was Brian Horton. And it works out well.
The James A. Tringali Memorial Scholarship goes to two players, Andy Dello Iacono and Alan Freeman, representing the Lakers and the Pistons, respectively.
Yes, I know both gentlemen very well, and good for them. I'm happy for them both, and I just hope Alan really uses it.
No, was that really nice to say? But you know you are the controversial one.
Yes, but I know Alan. I, you know, he's not very reliable. I love the kid. I love his family more than him, but, you know, I love the kid. He's just, you know, we've had our differences.
Well, we've neatly tied up the 20-08 season. Now we're opening with the 20-09 season. So what we're going to do, we're going to talk about each team. There's eight of them.
Nine.
How they finished last year. Teams one to teams eight. And then at the 30-minute mark, Brad, we're going to go into the pick'ems. But the first team...
Oh, that's today?
That's today.
Damn.
Well, you have roughly 20 minutes to figure out who you're picking, who's going, and who ain't going.
I need a dry erase board or something. I need a piece of chalk.
The defending Neighborhood League champs, the Sixers. The Sixers, they were definitely by far the best team in the land last year, Brad. As you remember, the Sixers had a 12-game win streak. They lost the last two regular season games. But in the madness, where it all counts, they came up big, first place, took home the jackets, the Sixers.
Yes, they did go on that 12-0 run, which was very good for them, very good for Cliff Williams. As his smile got bigger and bigger each week, you knew something was going to happen at some point. And lo and behold, he loses the last two. And I spoke to him right after that second loss going into the playoffs. I said, how you feel? Just before he came up on the Madness special here at around the rim. And he was just like, I can't believe I just lost. Two in a row. I could lose three in a row. I said, you possibly could. But you're in first place. You better suck it up and get those wins. So he loses two in a row, wins two in a row, wins the title.
If you would be kind, Brad, can you read the present roster of the Sixers?
The present roster.
The present roster. These Sixers are your defending Neighborhood League champs. And when you're the defending Neighborhood League champs, Brad, as you well know, you have a target on your back. All of the teams are gunning for you, and they broke a lot of hearts last season, Brad.
Oh, yeah. When you go 12-0 and not lose to anyone until the last two games of the season, a lot of people want to get their wins back. Because, you know, a lot of coaches, you know, they volunteer to do this, but they still have a little, you know, animosity towards each other. But it's nothing but love in the MNBL. You can go to any meeting and you'll see it. So the defending champions will be joined by Jimmy Nguyen, returner, Carlos Escobar.
I was just going to ask, is your skull cap on too tight?
No.
You didn't say it the way you usually say it.
Carlos Escobar, he's going to be there. He's a returner. Sean Hickey, Sammy Jean, I like to call him Kid Mountain Dew. Some people know what I mean. Ricky Douglas with two S's, Dimitri Lodimus, the big man in the middle, Sebastian Arano, and the new members of the defending champions who are going to feel the wrath from everybody else, John D. Oliveira running the point, Blake Coughlin, Terrell Sutton, Derek Solis, they call him Dickie, and Luis Matarazzo. That rounds off the 2009, or 2009, if you will, roster for the Sixers.
head coach for the Sixers, Cliff Williams. Last year, Mike McQuarto came on the show, got his jacket, but I haven't seen Mike McQuarto since the banquet. So is it APB or Mike McQuarto? Where the hell are you? The season already started. The Sixers 1-1. No one has seen Mike McQuarto since he took his jacket and bounced. Did he do what so many coaches threatened to do, get that jacket
and get
the hell out?
I don't know, but Cliff Williams said it himself. He goes, I have not seen or heard from Mike McQuarto. I don't know what stories are going on around there, but this is the truth. Cliff Williams told me I have not seen him since Friday night's tryout. That was the last time he saw or heard from him.
Well, I have to tell you, if he's in traffic, that's one hell of a long red light.
He doesn't even have a car. So he walked the wrong way or something. He must have got mixed directions.
Or maybe he's maybe he's waiting for that light to change to walk from to cross the street.
Oh, but I see. The stop sign and get it, yeah.
But in any case,
maybe the 104 is late.
Maybe the 104 is late. But in any case, Daryl Satterwhite.
Yes.
Is the assistant coach Cliff Williams brought him into the family.
Yes, and Daryl is very well known around this area. For those of you who don't know him, he has an older brother, Jeff. He's related to, you know, a bunch of people in the area. So Daryl is very welcome down here. A lot of us know of him before he even came here. We played basketball with him, and, you know, sometimes he hits his layups and sometimes you don't.
Team that came in second place, Brad, the Sonics. Blue-collar team, nice squad. The Sonics did not make it to the big dance last year, which shocked us both.
Yeah, I mean, we thought they had a shot. I mean, I think I predicted them fourth. I'm not too sure on that, but my memory is not that great. But yeah, the Sonics, we thought they were going to go.
Brad, fortunately, I watched last year's show on atrlive.com. This show right now is 14 minutes old, and I haven't even plugged the website yet, the blog,
atrlive.com.
We both had the Sonics.
Yes.
And we had the Sonics finishing, like, in first or second place, each one of us. We had it going, the big dance going up against the Sonics and the Hawks. I picked the Sonics. The Sonics didn't even make the big dance. You picked the Hawks, but the Hawks ended up losing to the Sixers.
Yes. I do remember picking the Hawks, and everyone called me crazy, and Bonaco thanked me for jinxing him. But it wasn't my fault, because you went to overtime. And if you just hit the layup, you would have won. So, and the free throws, and didn't throw the ball away, and stopped them from scoring.
And there was that one traveling incident.
And there was a traveling incident somewhere in there, and, you know, that guy who was wearing the yellow and the red didn't do what he was supposed to. But anyway, the Sonics this year will be manned by Juan German, Justin Crosby. What's up, Kyle? Michael O'Brien, OB they call him, Gene Borghella, and the newest members of the Sonics.
I'm going to do my best.
Siddiqui Ba Kaba.
Was a little bit better than what I would have done.
Okay. Ariel Hertz.
What happened to him?
I don't know. It must hurt.
Kensley Metalis. Keegan Wilcox, who's sporting the 1970s hairdo, I guess, with the headband he's got going on. Kind of like it. Reminds me of the Will Ferrell basketball movie.
It reminds me of you back in the day.
My hair was never like that, though.
Oh, I did have long hair, but...
I don't know. Look at the old pictures. Look at the album.
Oh, well, maybe when I was drunk. Ryan Tam and Caleb Hopkins, who got hops. That is your Sonics for 09.
The change in the coaching staff is that Jeremy Rocker...
Oh, yes.
...is the new head coach. Gary Rogers stepped down to be an assistant coach. The first time we seen Gary, Brad... was Saturday, the Sonics season opener against the Lakers. The Sonics were losers. First time Gary Rogers has seen those guys, and he said he was so disgusted by the way they played that he was going to be at practice tonight, and he's bringing back, he's dusting off the medicine ball.
Oh, not the medicine ball.
The medicine ball, Brad.
That gives me nerves, and I'm not even there.
Same here, and I wouldn't care about anything like that. And he said those dudes are not going to touch a basketball tonight. They're going back to their roots.
Oh, well, you know, I feel bad for those of the, you know, those folks who do have to put up with that, but, you know, it worked. They came in second. No, I'm sorry. I'm thinking of someone else. They did go to the Madness the year before, you know, going back to the roots. So if it works, you go with it. If it doesn't, you know, all you can say is you get some, you know, muscles out of the whole deal.
Team that came in third place, Brad, the hip-hop-led Hawks in butt-naked last season before, back to the Madness, finished in third spot. They went to the big dance. almost took the big dance, Brad.
Yes, the Hawks, you know, they for three straight seasons, they finish in second place.
Yes.
And then they miss. Then they come back.
And finish in third.
And finish in third. Okay, that works. This close to nailing my prediction, but I guess the Will Smith character and the dreads and everything got in the way at the very end of the game, and the Sixers just got their victory, you know, to go along with their first place trophies. So they got it all. But I mean, I really, really did think the Hawks were going to win it this past season. I am a little sad that they didn't, but I'm also happy for Cliff because I'm friends with everybody. So at least I hope so. So the Hawks this season, Peterson or Relis, not Norrellis, he knows his name this year, Jace Kyle, who I really, really like, Brandon Naylor, who's nailing down them threes, his shot looks even better, John McMillan.
Chilling like a McMillan.
Chilling like a McMillan, looks like a skater or a surfer. You know, he's got the long hair now. The newest members are Gary Forrester, Inaldo Okendo, Brandon Moran, Scott Jules, Marco Jean Baptiste, I guess he's the cousin, and David Consol, who is yet to play due to an injury to his jaw. And that is your 09 Hawks.
Once again, Bernacco Stroud is the head coach of the Hawks. Javon Walcott, Milton Osborne are the assistant. Team that came in fourth place, Brad, and this is a team that I threw on the floor last year, Brad, the Bullets. We've said it before, when you win two titles in 3 years, that makes you one dynasty. I didn't think the Bullets had a squad to make the madness.
No one did.
They proved me wrong, Brad.
Yeah, they had two really, really good sophomores that just, they if Shaq didn't make the high school team this season, I think they would go right back to where they were, if not higher. The draft was not as strong this year, but when you have two people of that caliber, that just makes your team better.
The other person being?
Shakira Samexin, the man known as Shaq.
And Jerome Dean.
And Jerome Dean, yes, who is still a member of the Bullets. He is, I guess, the captain, maybe, maybe not. Jerome Dean, Steven Eshuk, who has put on at least 7 ounces. Jonathan Chongson, Suna Champsidine, who slimmed down quite nicely. Jeffrey Legentis, and the newest members, Chris Terrilli, Alex Andon, Tyler Cronin, Brett Miller, Brendan Provatola, and Aaron Simano, the big man in the middle.
I want to talk about Chris Terrilli just for a couple of minutes, if I can, Brad. You don't mind about
it's
that.
It's your show. You do what you got to do.
I have to tell you, the lineage that the Terrilli family has with the MNBL, the first season of the MNBL, 1986, the Hawks head coach was Sal Terrilli. Sal Terrilli,
yes.
The late Sal Terrilli, Chris Terrilli's grandfather.
Mm-hmm.
So Sal Terrilli was the very first coach of the Hawks, okay? From 1987 to 1989, the coach was Chris Terrilli's father, Mike Terrilli. The first 5 seasons of the MNBL, the Hawks went to the big dance all 5 seasons.
Wow.
But they only won once, and that was in 1989. And in 1989, Mike Terrilli, Chris Bennett, they finally got that title. They were the first coaches to get that title and get the hell out of Dodge. But that's what happened. So, and there are other coaches that have followed suit, and it appears that Mike McQuarto might be the latest coach
yes,
to have
I'm
done
here.
That. But this is Chris Terrilli's lineage in the MNBL. So I just wanted to point that
and
out.
And didn't he referee as well?
Mike Terrilli was a referee,
yes.
Mike has a younger brother, David Terrilli, who also refed, and both Terrillis used to ref in the ALBL.
Were they good refs?
Absolutely.
Okay. I agree.
So,
hey,
once again,
is there any other kind?
Well, there are. There are not.
What happened was, as we were saying, the Pistons were next, right?
Well, before we get to Pistons, Steve Wright, who's been here since day one, baby.
Yes.
He doesn't let you forget it. Mark Gagnon. And the other, what's his name? Vinny Cianci.
And don't forget Kevin Benner.
And Kevin Benner. Yes. I don't have the coaches written down this year, Brad, but in any case, the Bullets coaching squad are still solid. And, of course, Bullet Boosters, Grassy Girls.
Yes. And now we go to the
The Pistons.
Before you switch on.
Uh-oh.
You're talking about the Bullets and the Bullet coaches. Did you you might want to mention about the about Steve Wright showing up at Bullets Blue off of MNBL19.tripod.com.
We could do that.
Yes.
We could mention that if anybody's interested in the official website for the MNBL. It is MNBL19, the numbers, not the word. MNBL19.tripod.com.
And what I forgot to plug at the tap, Brad, was that...
ATLive.com?
I forgot to plug MNBL19.tripod.com.
Oh.
If you go to that website, on the front page, you can purchase MNBL apparel along with each individual team apparel. This feature was added to the website the last weekend of the season last year.
Yes.
So we have a whole season to plug MNBL apparel. Once again, you go to MNBL19.tripod.com. And I don't know why that screens
up,
Brad.
This is up.
This is not
the
end
of
the show.
Website on there if you want the
it
correct
does.
Spelling. But, you know, I see where they were going with it. It is the first show. But,
well,
yes, MNBL19.tripod.com.
That was done without direction, by the way.
Your official MNBL shirts, apparel, or pick your own favorite team. I might go get a Laker jersey.
Now we could. You will?
I might.
I might get a Kings myself.
I hear you.
Now to the team that came in fifth place, the Pistons. Brad, for the past couple of seasons, we both had the Pistons going, and for the past couple of seasons, the Pistons haven't gone. I don't know if they want to go or not.
I don't want to pick them just so they can go. But yeah, the Pistons being led by Chuck Washington, Charles, if you will, Steve Sands, returner who has slimmed down, Kyle Rufo, Eddie Pierre, Mackenzie Noel, Bellen Daniel, last year's champion, and the newest members of the Pistons, former Celtic cousin to Bellen Daniel, Danny B2 in a big trade, Hervé Charles, who no one got to see in the tryouts because he wasn't available, got picked up by the Pistons, and he seems to be a very good rebounder. Ricky McCoy, who was property last year, didn't qualify, came back this year.
The real McCoy.
And Lucas Njemi, and he has a very good background sports-wise, Lucas, and he has a very good family. They are one-on-one personal trainers at the Melrose YMCA. If you want to go down there, go see Joe or the lovely Mrs. Njemi. You can go on down there. They're personal trainers. And Lucas, brother, I happen to coach in baseball, so, you know, those, they
Troy?
Have...
Troy?
Troy, yep. Doing very well, very good pitcher, very good hitter. Reminds me of a small Pedroia. But, you know, very good athletes, both of them. And Lucas Njemi, I guess, will be running the point for the Pistons, and that rounds out their roster in 09.
Paul Conrad, PC, head man,
yes.
Head coach for the Pistons. Howard Jones, Anthony Guerrero, coming back to help out Paul Conrad and the Pistons.
And Marcus Bailey.
And I forgot.
And it's not written down,
it's
I
not
understand.
Written down. And Marcus Bailey, graduate last year, coming back, giving back to the league. We always love to see that, Brad.
Yes, always.
The next team up, Brad, the Kings. The Kings had a... You're moaning already.
I was just chilled.
The Kings had a lean season last season.
Yeah, right? Kings did not return to the form that they had going to the madness, to the big dance 2 years in a row. Come back the next year. They knew it was going to be tough. But it was just, you know, one of those seasons. They knew it was going to be rough. They didn't expect to go. We didn't pick them to go. So their roster for 09 is Robert Iapica, Irvin Pierre, Taquan Ross, Andrew J-Man. The newest members will be Ravi Pandey. I thought it was Pandey, but it's Pandey.
When it was Vishnu, it was Vishnu Pandey.
Yeah, but he never corrected us. It was Pandey, but he never corrected anyone. So that's his loss. And we happened to see Vishnu recently, and he got big. He looks like a man.
And he decided to correct you.
Yes. Well, actually, Ravi did. If you call his cell phone, he's, you know, it's kind of hip-hop. Anyway, Scott Benson, Teddy Francois, Hintsa Hagos, not Hintsu, Jeff Chabray. Yes, he is the brother of Matt Chabray of the Celtics last year. And Ed DiGiovanni.
They got an Italian on their squad. That is the 09 Kings.
Chris Rogers, head man for the Kings. Glenn Higgins, Krista Vega coming back. Another season with the Kings. Next team, the Celtics. Another team that had a lean season last season, Brad.
Yeah, the Celtics last year, it was a little tough. They kept thinking they were on the brink of something special, and the next thing you know...
They were on the brink of another loss.
Another loss, exactly. Due to maybe some hotheads on the team, they couldn't quite get their chemistry. Due to just not having the people that they expected to return.
They had a target on the back because they were defending neighborhood league champs.
Yes, they were. The target was bigger than ever, And when your big rebounder returner doesn't return, it kind of makes you even that much weaker because people know you have a sore spot and they're going to attack it. So that was that. But in 09, it will be Mike Abramo, Natson Jackson, which you like his name.
Love that name. Like I said, that's the been doing this now for 17 years. The league has been around for 24 years, and that is the best name to ever come into the MNBL. And you never did answer the question. Did you see that movie Natson Jackson starring Vanity?
No, I saw a movie starring Kyle Weathers. It was similar to that, though.
Oh.
Yeah,
it was a Natson Jackson?
I don't think it was Natson.
Oh.
It had a lot of action.
But it wasn't Natson?
No, action.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
So, Natson Jackson?
Yes!
Oh, okay.
Yes.
So it was Natson Jackson.
Well, it was close. Okay. So that was the only two returners for the Celtics this year. So their very thin season could be thinner. The rest of their roster will be Chris Mannion, Joe Kanin, Brian Young, Jacob Bautista. Wonder if he's related to Dave. Kyle White, Duong Hua.
No, it's pronounced Young.
Young Hua.
Yes.
Young Hua. Okay. And Keithier Eloy rounds out the 09 roster for the Celtics.
Brian Young is kinfolk to Joe Young, to Mighty Joe Young.
I think they're a very athletic squad. I think they're very athletic. They're speedy and they're just short.
I believe he's Mighty Joe Young's nephew, I believe. I could be wrong, but it is kinfolk.
It is there is a relation somewhere.
The Magic Man, Even Revere, is the head coach of the Celtics. Now the team that had the leanest season of them all, one season gone, the Lakers, the boys in the purple and gold, Brad.
Yes, I never thought a team would smile so much after coming in dead last. And it seems that the smile still is on the face of the Lakers coaching staff to this day. For other reasons, obviously. But the Lakers last year, yes, it was a tough season. They did have a couple, let's say, obstacles on the squad, whether it be coaching or players.
But those
obstacles seem to be missing now.
The problem with the Lakers last year, Brad, I'll tell you what the problem was. The problem was that the Lakers was one big sideshow for 14 games. Why do I say that? I'll tell you why I said that, Brad.
Okay, good.
Because you had players that wanted to argue with themselves.
Yes.
You had players that wanted to argue with the coaches. You had players that wanted to argue with the referees. And these same players did not do the right thing on the offseason, the season before.
That's true.
Because this team was their team. They inherited that team. And when you have five returners, and when three of those five returners admitted to Beanie Amos, and Beanie Amos did thank them for their honesty, admitted to Beanie Amos that the last time they touched the basketball was the last game of the season before. When you have one returner who claimed to have touched the basketball over the offseason, but both Beanie Amos and now it's Reverend Bernard Stroud knew at the first practice that person didn't do it. So you had one returner that actually improved upon his game. So when you have that five, but four of the five don't do the right things, it's a long season, and that's what happened to the Lakers last year.
And that one returner has returned that much better, I believe. So
that one returner graduated.
Oh, was it?
Yes.
It wasn't the one I'm thinking then.
No, not the one that you were thinking.
Okay, so the one I'm thinking about is on top of the list. Sean Fortier is in the roster. Wen Zhu, Jorsa Joseph, and the newest members to the Laker squad is Casey Staton, Kevin Alacon, Mike Almeida, who was on the team last year but due to an injury could not play, John Liu, John Vilsaint, yes, it sounds familiar on the Lakers, Donnell Bailey, and Billy Hurley, the big man in the middle, round out the 09 roster for the Lakers.
Brad, I think we are right on time. So it is.
Oh, goodness.
It is 30 minutes past the hour or 30 minutes of the hour, however you want to look at it. And now
we're done, right?
No, we're not done. It's time for the pick'ems, Brad. The goings and the eight goings.
You sure that's today?
That's today. The goings and the eight goings.
I thought it was a half-hour show.
No. It's the one-hour season premiere. That's what I said at the tap, Brad.
It's been cold in Holderness this year, so sorry.
Well, Bug Tuzzle had gone through an unusual cold spell itself. So,
you
Brad,
didn't get hit with the ice storm, did you?
No.
Yeah.
But, Brad, what I'm doing is I'm shifting through the goings and the eight goings, and that's what I'm doing right now. And you know what, Brad?
Should I do that?
You should do the same thing. And you know what, Brad? As I said, I watched the show today, again, last year's season premiere on ATRLive.com, where I offered you to go first, and you said no, you wanted me to go first. Then I went first. I picked the goings, the ain't goings, and then you said, how am I supposed to follow that act So, and then I had said on the show, I asked you if you wanted to go first, Brad, for which you answered, well, maybe we should switch it up. Maybe next year you pick the eight goers, and I'll pick the eight goers, and you pick the goers, and I'll pick the goings, and all that stuff. So, Brad, I'm going to ask you while I'm still shuffling, how do you want to do this? Do you want to go first, or do you want me to go first?
I'm confused. I think you should go first because I'm still shuffling.
Do you want me to do the eight goings and the goings, or do you want me to do the eight goings and then you come with your eight goings, I go with my goings, you go with your goings? Talk to me, brother.
All right, I'm going to say you go with your eight goings and then bring it to me.
Okay.
And then we'll bring it back and then we'll go back to
me. And when I do this, Brad, are you going to be ready?
I'm hoping so. I'm going with that. I'll just leave it at that for now.
Okay. So the goings and the eight goings. What
yes.
I have... My hands, two piles.
I got two piles.
I have the goings, and I have the eight goings. And I'm going to do the eight goings first.
Okay, I have
okay?
them in the opposite hands.
And
I'll
have to tell
them.
You something, Brad. This is, as we said, the 24th year of the MNBL. And I'm having problems with the goings and the eight goings. It isn't,
yeah, that's what I'm doing.
It isn't, to me, as clear-cut as it appears to be in past years, the four that are clearly going
yes.
and the four that are clearly tank going. So right now I have of the ain't goings, five teams, and obviously one of them has to go.
Well, that is true.
I'm going to have to edit on the fly, but I'm pretty sure that the first team that ain't going, Brad, are the Celtics. This year's Celtics team, Brad, only have nine players. Everyone else has 10. There's one team that has 11. There might be one team, I think the Bulls, that has 12 players.
I think the Sixers have 12.
Oh, the Sixers have 12. One team has 12, but the Celtics have nine players, okay? Now, one of the Celtics draft picks, matter of fact, the Celtics first round pick ended up being ineligible. So
ouch.
That, yes, so that hurts the franchise.
Second
so
pick.
So this Celtics team, Brad, just tanked going. And Brad, I think this Celtics team could do what no other Celtics team have done in the past 23 years. This Celtics team, Brad, has a legitimate shot of finishing butt naked last. The Celtics are the
where?
Only butt naked last.
That would be in last place.
That would be butt naked last.
Wow.
Butt naked last. There has never been a Celtic team that has finished in butt naked last. The Celtics are the only team in the MNBL that have never finished butt naked last. So, Brad, the Celtics just tank going.
Okay.
The defending Neighborhood League champions, Brad, the Sixers. The Sixers just tank going.
Okay.
Why?
Why?
Because I'll tell you why. They do not have inside presence. Their big man, Dimitri Lodimus, instead of playing down low big like he should be playing, he's playing more of a Kevin Garnett, playing outside, trying to shoot on the perimeter. He does have a nice shot, but they need somebody.
They've lost 6 of 8, by the way.
But they, yes, they have.
Yes.
But we're talking about the Sixers, not,
oh,
the,
yes, that's
MN,
true.
Not the NBA Celtics. And the Lodimus he wants to shoot outside. Ricky Douglas with two S's.
Yes.
He's still firing it up. He's still firing it up. Ricky Douglas, he's possibly going to lead the league in scoring this year.
He was 7 for 43 in the first game.
Which might be a personal goal of his. I'm not sure. But I do not see this team playing as a team. I see a bunch of individuals. There was a couple of members of this team, Brad, that I know before the season was asking a certain team to be traded to that team, and that's just not going to happen. So when you have your defending Neighborhood League champions in this disarray, Mike McQuarto, who is still missing, Brad, the Sixers just tank going.
Okay.
Brad, the Sonics, the blue-collar team, the team that has been working hard the past couple of seasons, Brad, the Sonics just tank going. I see the Sonics shooting too many outside shots, not trying to go inside down low. Mike O'Brien cannot do his thing on the offense if he doesn't get his hands on the ball. He's down low doing work, but the rest of the boys want to shoot around the perimeter. They want to launch it beyond the arc where everything is three. I do not see the Sonics. The Sonics just tank going. Now, Brad, we have the Bullets and the Kings. Now, with the Bullets, I said last year the Bullets wasn't going. But Steve Wright has the means and has the coaching knowledge to get the most out of his players. And last season, Brad, a season gone, I didn't see the Bullets going. You saw that the Bullets was a better team than what I saw. You pointed out Sammy Fanfan.
Yep.
You pointed out the Shaq man. You pointed out Jerome Dean. Well, we both knew Jerome Dean
oh, absolutely.
Was all that. and the Bullets managed to start off nice in the beginning and just maintain the fourth place position. Mm-hmm. The Kings, Brad, the Kings, to me, they look good. What the Kings have to realize, Brad, is that their strength is on the inside, not on the outside. In the Jamboree, Brad, the Pistons were killing the Kings in the first half. The Kings, at the half, made the adjustments. They realized that their game was down low. They wasn't shooting outside. And the Kings didn't have a full squad. They lost that game to the Pistons, Brad. But they came back on the Pistons. Matter of fact, at halftime, I forget what the Pistons were, but the Kings were nine. Nine.
Yes.
And they came back and only lost it in less than double digits, I believe. I believe they lost the game, the Jamboree game, in single digits. I know at one point they came within one because they were going on the inside. So, and that was when that was without a full squad. So this is where I'm torn. I'm torn between the Kings and the Bullets for that fourth slot. And this is what I'm going to do, Brad. I'm going to go on the limb, and I'm going to say that it's going to be the Kings. Brad, have you realized that the Kings and the Lakers have never gone at the same time?
No.
They've never gone at the same time. I think this year the Kings and the Lakers could go at the same time. The Kings did lose their season opener. They lost it to the Lakers. But I don't want to judge the Kings on that because the Lakers, in my opinion, are a better team than the Kings this year. I think that we didn't see the Kings' best effort in the season opener. I think that a lot of things are going up against the Kings that game. Practices were canceled last Tuesday for all the teams. As I said, they had a couple of guys that wasn't at the Jamboree that was at the first game. They played on Sunday. The Lakers had a benefit of playing a Saturday game. So I don't think that first game is truly indicative of this Kings team. I think the Kings can put it together and come. So the Bullets just ain't going. Okay? But I do want to say one thing, Brad. A couple of seasons are gone. I said I instilled a right to rescind. And what that right to rescind means is that I can take one team and swap. So what I'm going to do by the halfway point, by the midseason report card. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to use my right to rescind. I put forth that I have the option to use my right to rescind and swap only the Bullets and the Kings at the halfway mark.
Okay.
Okay. And you could do the same, but it has to be only the two teams that you select tonight.
Okay.
Because the Jamboree was a couple of weeks ago. All teams had three practices. So I don't think all the teams are as good as what they could be at this point. Usually at this point, Brad, all eight teams have like five or six practices.
This is true.
Six of them had three. Two of them had four. So, but that's how I see it right now. So those are the tank goings. Now the teams that I see going, we just talked about the Kings. I think the
Are we coming back to me?
Oh, I'm sorry, Brad.
It was your rule.
It was my rule, and I don't even pay attention to myself, Brad.
You're throwing in clauses and skipping over Brad.
That just ain't fair.
No, it's not. I thought I, you know, was I'm kind of ready, but
I'm sorry, Brad. Go ahead.
Okay, so I now let me
don't
feel
be stuttering.
Same.
You told me you were ready.
I feel the same as you. I feel there's I'm on the brink. I got five. I got three. I got three taints. I got five. Who knows? So I'm gonna just start off with I let me move it. I absolutely agree. I think with the mistake or the faux pas that happened with the Celtics not getting their first pick eligible for this game or for this season, that hurts them a lot. I watched the Jamboree. I watched the first game that they played, and I see a very athletic and hustling team. But like I said earlier, I see a short team. And without rebounding here in the MNBL, most of the time you have a rough, rough season. So I agree. I don't know if they're going to do the OFA. They do have a shot. I'm not against it. I don't know if it'll happen, but it's a possibility. But they definitely ain't going.
So throw them on the floor, Brad.
Oh, sorry. it's got a tight zoom, so. Floating to the floor. Okay, the second team I don't see going, I do not see the Hawks going. Simply because they don't have that stereotypical, go-to guy like they've had the past three seasons when they finished in second. Last year they finished in third. They always had a go-to man, and they always had that person to, just light up the scoreboard. This year, yes, they have a John McMillan, but will he be able to stay out of foul trouble? Will he be able to stay out of technical foul trouble? Will he be able to stay calm? As well as Jace Carl, who I think is one of the most exciting players in the MNBL this season. I'm going to say it. I think he's the most exciting player. I think he's got more hustle in him than most of these teams down here.
Brad, I got a quick question for you.
Okay.
Who do you think is the most exciting player in the MNBL this season?
I'm going with Chase Collins.
Are you?
Yes.
Okay.
I'll go with him.
I was just wondering that.
Now you know. Okay. All right. So, but I don't see the Hawks going simply because they don't have that, and there's some problems with their first pick overall too. So with the in problems going on and the situation with their first pick, they have too many problems. Ain't going. Third team ain't going. Sorry, Jeremy, first year as the head coach. I don't see the Sonics going either. I just don't think you have that Justin Richardson kid who can just take off down the court. You don't have that Chris Leaston who's going to get you the board, fly down the other end. And it's, I mean, Siddiqui Ba is going to be incredible, but I think there's just too much pressure on him. Can't just keep relying on him. You got to find OB the ball, and it's going to be tough when you're just trying to outshoot everyone. It's going to be a strong season for you as a head coach for the first time. Gary will give you all the knowledge he can, I'm sure, but I'm sorry, just ain't going. I really can't say too much about it. Now this is where I'm tossed. But I'm just going to say it straight out. I don't think the Bullets are going. And I'm going to tell you why.
Fred, I'm interested in why, in your opinion, you don't think the Bullets are going.
Well, I'm going to tell you why.
Thank you.
Okay. Now the Bullets. We've said that we keep dropping them, saying they ain't going. Okay. They ended up going. All right, so we made a mistake. We've been known to do that. But again, this is a rescind pick. I just don't see the Bullets going because Jerome Dean's going to have a lot on his plate. Without Shaq helping him with rebounds, yes, he does have a talented Provotola grabbing some boards, Samano, and, they do have some people to chip in. I just don't think they're quick enough. I don't think they're fast enough. I mean, Jerome Dean is all world. He can score at will if he wants to. But they just don't have that guy to complement him. And through the season, someone could step up, or two people. But as of right now, just from what I've seen, yes, they won a game, and they lost a game. But, in my opinion, I just don't see the Bullets going because they need that complement to Jerome Dean. And right now, they do not have it. So they ain't going. And those are my four.
So now it's my turn.
Now it'd be your turn because that's how, we talked about it earlier.
In my hand, I have the four are going. And Brad, as I said, the last time I had the floor,
okay,
was that the Kings are going. I don't think that we truly seen the true Kings team. I seen this team come back in the Jamboree. I'll be with the Jamboree, yes, and that game doesn't count. But that Pistons squad is a good squad, and they came back on a good squad. The Kings game is down low. Their players might not know that their game's down low. They were taking too many outside shots in their season opener against the Lakers. And in the first half, that was a very close game between the Lakers and the Kings. And it took both teams almost the entire 10 minutes to even score. So the Kings, I don't think we truly seen the true Kings, but I do see the Kings going. So the Kings, the Kings are going. Now the Hawks, I see the Hawks. This is where you and I differ. I see the Hawks going, okay? Because you know why, Brad? Tell you why.
Tell me why.
I'll tell you why.
Okay, you said it.
In the 2006 season, in a 2006 season, the Hawks, the Hip Hoppers, they had two guys, okay? They had Rubens Legentes, and they had Jamie Guess. And at that time, Brad, I said they wasn't going. They ain't going. I threw them on the floor because it would take more than just those two guys, okay? Well, that was three seasons are gone. This season, Brad, they're two guys, John McMillan, Jace Carl. Now, we've seen the hip-hop coaches take a squad where you have two guys to carry the entire team. I think lightning can strike twice, and I think that the Hawks can go. During the head coaching career of Bonaco Stroud with Jovan Walcott, Milton Osborne, they get the most out of their players. Three of those guys know the game of basketball, and they can coach. So I think that although they're going to have to coach a little bit harder this year, I think those three guys have the tools to coach harder and get the most out of this team to get them in madness contention. So I see the Hawks going. Brad, this team, the Pistons, when I saw last year's Around the Rim on ATRLive.com, We had said 1 year ago that we keep picking this Pistons team to go, and this Pistons team just doesn't go. Last season, Brad, I said the Pistons team was going to go because, in my opinion, they were better than the four teams that I said wasn't going, tank going. And the Pistons, of course, didn't go. But I think, Brad, with this year, I think the Pistons have the tools to definitely go. So the Pistons are going. The Pistons, they can open up that floor with the perimeter shooting. Bell and Daniel, the defending three-point champion, and also has a couple of three-point records, and he's only played one season, Brad. You got Lucas Enjamy that can hit the three ball, and now you got Danny B2, kinfolk of Bell and Daniel. I think they're going to be deadly from the outside, the perimeter. What they need to do, they need to work on the inside game because Chuck Washington can't do it by himself. So I see the Pistons going. And the Lakers, Brad, I see the Lakers. BD Amos told me that when the season ended last year, he pulled his three returners, which was Wenzhou, Sean Fortier, and Joseph Joseph, and said that he vows that next season they will not have a season like they did, like they've gone through. Beanie Amos and Reverend Bernard Stroud made a pact that they would never, ever go through a season like that again. They're going to draft accordingly. They are just going to assume that the returners didn't do the right thing. And they, quote, if they have to pick seniors all the time and just retool every year until they finish coaching, that they will do that. But I see this Lakers team going. So, Brad, I have the four teams that are going. Now, how do I see the madness?
Okay, let me interrupt you. Do you want to do that, or do you want me to do my four?
I like that. I like that idea.
Okay, then we'll do that. Okay, so I'm going to do with my four. Now, these are, obviously you know which four that I have going since process of elimination. If you're following along at home on TV or atilive.com, you can always go there and check it out. I agree. I absolutely think the Lakers are going. I absolutely think the Lakers have a very strong squad, and with a true, pure point guard finally on their squad, I think it's a very nice compliment to their big man in the middle, a very good compliment to their star shooter, who is the best all-around player on their team. But that pure point guard is going to make them that much better, so I don't see any flaw in the Laker offense this season.
And who's that pure point guard?
That would be Donnell Bailey.
Okay. I would think he's the pure point guard on that squad.
Okay. I love him.
No, I just wanted
to energize a bunny.
I just wanted you to tell the folks. That's
okay.
All.
I think he's an unbelievable point guard. Okay, I'll agree with you there too. I'm gonna say the Pistons will, they're gonna shine on the 3-point line. They're gonna shine on certain things, and I agree. Chuck Washington cannot do it all by himself.
In the paint.
The problem with Chuck Washington is, I like Chuck, and I razz him all the time, but he knows it's all in fun. It's nothing but love. He's a 3-year player. I've known him for 3 years. I feel comfortable razzing him. But Chuck has a problem. Chuck can't seem to stay out of the dozens every year, and if he's on that bench,
that's my favorite category.
He's not going to have. That is your favorite category.
Remember, Chuck Washington's rookie year, he was the dirtiest dozen of them all.
Absolutely, and he was second last year, wasn't he?
I forgot to look at it before.
I believe he was second.
But he was up there. You can go to atilive.com and check it out.
I think John Jean won it, and Chuck Washington was second. So you go to atilive.com and check it out. Yeah, right. But I think if he's in trouble on the bench, it's going to hurt them because they're going to have to rely on the three-pointer. Yes, and Jemmy can hit it. Yes, Bellin obviously can hit it. Danny B2, I think, is going to play that much better. I didn't think he was a great Celtic. I didn't think he was that good last year. But when you're playing with kinfolk, I think it brings you up that much more and makes you feel more comfortable.
I was just going to say, sometimes some players are just on the wrong team for whatever reason.
Yes.
And that could be the case with Danny B2.
It definitely could be. And I think Hervé Charles is going to surprise people. I think he wasn't in at the tryouts. The Pistons took him out of a whim. And I think he's going to be a real good rebounder for them. Offensively, maybe not. But rebounding, I think he's going to help. And Ricky McCoy, we just don't know yet. He has potential to light it up.
He has potential to stink it up.
Okay, I'll go with that. And, of course, you have to worry about, their point guard situation. Is he going to run too far ahead of him? Is he going to wait for him? And, Paul Conrad always has something to say about something. Whose man was that? Or give me the D or something.
That's Steve Wright.
It is?
Yes.
Okay, well then.
Give me the D.
Well, Paul Conrad is definitely, whose man is that? But I think, if Chuck can stay out of foul trouble, their three-pointers are on point. Teams are going to figure it out sooner or later. They're going to have to learn to shoot perimeter, not just threes. And I see the Pistons going. They have a good enough offense to make it.
The Kings, yes. The Kings, I think you, I absolutely agree, you have not seen the best of the Kings. I'm not saying they are the best this season, but they definitely, you know, that jamboree, they did come back missing two starters. They were not in the house. One was in Canada. One was ill. It was okay. It was the jamboree, but they did come back. They did, I believe, lose by like 11 or 12, but they did come back, cut it down to one, and it just fell apart at the end.
And they came back on the Pistons.
And they came back on a full Piston squad with the starting five on the out there with the Kings' two bench players on the court. So I think they're good enough to make it. Where they finish, I'm not sure, but I believe the Kings can make it. They have a lot of raw talent that has to be fixed, and they need to fix it quickly. And the team that I surprise pick, no one expected me to say this, I think the Sixers are going. Yes, I think Cliff Williams is a good enough coach to do it. Daryl Satterwhite will get the best out of his players. He knows how to push the buttons. He's not going to scream at you, but he will yell. So he has a very strong voice. And I think with Dimitri Lodomus down low, if they can keep him down low, like Nesta said, he likes to play a little too far out. If they can push him down low and realize where he is, Ricky Douglas does not have to shoot every single time down the court. He needs to distribute the ball. Yes, he'll probably lead the league in scoring. Doesn't make you an MVP, but he can probably do that. And if you can get your point guard, D. Oliveira, to just calm down, find the man. He has very good vision, very good handle. I think that complements them too. And Jimmy Nguyen, you know, he doesn't commit fouls, so he's steady on the court. I just think they have a couple players, and don't underestimate Derek Solis. I know a lot of people have said, oh, he's not that good. The boy's been dropping 6 to 8 points the past couple games. He dropped a couple in there. He's a big boy, and if Cliff can control him and keep him in the center, he takes up a lot of room, and that's going to help Dimitri sneak in there and stay down low, as well as Ricky, who likes the baseline, likes the three. Actually, he hasn't seen a shot he hasn't liked all year. So I think they can make it. They just it might be a squeaker, but again, I'm going to put this with my other pick as a, you know, I can rescind it at the halfway point.
So what would be the two teams?
It would be the Sixers and the Bullets.
Okay. Okay. And who did you say that hadn't seen a shot this season that he hasn't liked?
Ricky Douglas.
Well, I'll do you one favor, one better, his entire career.
Okay, fair enough.
Okay.
You would know.
Yeah.
Okay. And now we go to the where are they going to finish and what's going to happen?
Yes, that's my turn.
Okay, right, now it's your turn again. We go back to you.
Where they're going to finish and what's going to happen as I see it. Okay, I see the Lakers finishing in the top spot. I see the Pistons finishing two. I see the Hawks finishing three and the Kings finishing four. That's the way I see it.
Okay.
So now I see the first round of the Madness. As I said, the first half hour of the show, that there has never been a scenario ever since Chris Rogers took over head coach of the Kings back in 1991 that the Lakers and the Kings went to the Madness at the same time. It has never happened. Look in the MNBL history books. It has never happened. This season, I think it's going to happen. So the first round, you're going to have the Lakers going against the Kings, and I see the Lakers advancing, the Kings not advancing. So this that brings you to the second game, the second-place Pistons up against the third-place Hawks. I think the Hawks are going to finish in third place, obviously, because I just said that.
You did.
And I think that the Hawks are going to get the best of the Kings to get that third-place, third-seeded slot on here. But in any case, I see the Pistons with the outside perimeter shooting getting the Hawks. Now the Pistons did beat the Hawks the season opener this year, Brad, but the Hawks were not at 100% capacity.
Right.
And the next time these two teams play, and I'm not going to shout out the reason why, but the next time these two teams play is going to be a game to watch because...
Does it have to do with karma?
It has to do with karma.
Okay.
It has to do with karma.
No? I heard some rumors
somewhere. So it's going to be, you know, so I see these teams probably splitting the regular season. But when it comes to the Madness, I see the Pistons getting past the Hawks. So the Hawks not advancing, the Pistons advancing. So now, Brad, the way I see it, I see the first place Lakers, team one, going against team two would be the Pistons, and your 20-09 champions, Brad, giving it to the boys in the purple and gold, and the Lakers are going to be one of the very few teams to go from worse to first.
Okay, fair enough. I think this is going to be pretty funny because I somewhat agree with a lot of that. So I'm going to go with, I'll just say it. The Lakers, I think, will finish first. I agree the Pistons will finish second. Now, with my rescind vote at the halfway point, it could change, but I see the Kings in third, and I see the Sixers in fourth. Just because the Kings, I think, are a better overall team than the Sixers, as long as they get their stuff together. So I see them in third, They finish a lot of times in third place for some reason. They like that third slot. And that would put the Lakers with quite an easy victory over the Sixers if that's how it ends up. I see the Lakers, no matter what, going to the big dance. I just see they have too much firepower with that pure point guard, that pure big man in the middle.
Who is?
And that would be Billy Hurley in the middle, and the pure point guard would probably be Donnell Bailey. And with, you know, Joseph just flying up and down the court, and Wenzu hitting the perimeters, it's a tough squad to defend. You have to be, like, right up on them and, you know, hopefully.
And Sean Fortier,
Sean Fortier, the most hustling Laker on the squad, I think is going to just dominate boards whenever he feels like it. They will have no problem going to the big dance. The Kings versus the Pistons, I see a dogfight. I really do. And it could go back to the 2001 season when the Pistons beat the Kings three straight times, went to the madness, went to the big dance, ended up, the Kings ended up beating the Pistons in the big dance for their only championship, winning by six. But this year, I'm not too sure. I see the Pistons going to the big dance to face the Lakers. I have to agree with you on that. And I'm even going to agree with you on something else. Purple and gold win it.
Lordy B, we agree.
We agree for the first time in years.
Yeah, I'm having a heart attack back here.
Huh? You almost had a heart attack?
Almost.
Yeah, I got to tell you, I was on the edge because I thought he was going to pick the Kings over the Pistons. And I thought he was leading that way.
Me too.
But when he said the Pistons, I was like, oh, Lordy B. Elizabeth, I'm coming to join you, honey. Hey. Let's go. How much time do we have?
We've got about a minute and a half.
Oh, God. Well, we're going to kill this right now.
Oh, that's no problem, man. I just, that's how I feel. That's all.
Bradworth, early Benton, season. I want to thank you for representing and coming this first season.
Thank you for having me again.
You will be back here, the mid-season report card, halfway, where we're going to see where we're going to talk about where they're finishing up until that point, and one of us or both of us might use our right to rescind.
Yes.
So until then, I just want to say buenas noches, hoochas, cooches. I came in peace. I leave with love. This is for the red, the black, and the green, and I'll be seeing you at the games. Thank you, Go Ref Go, for putting up the slate. I didn't tell him to put up all this. There was no red down here.
No, he just put up the slate. That's all right. But don't forget, MNBL19.tribal.com, ATRLive.com. You can go to those two websites. And, if you want to read them, they're always on the Malden Evening News, hopefully every Friday. If not, Saturday, maybe Monday, if the stats are in time.
Around the Rim will be back on next Thursday at 8:30. And I forgot to say at the tap that we're also on Verizon, so you can see us.
7:30.
7:30, and thank you, Brad.
Yes.
I got to say, we're also on Verizon, which is channel 28 on Verizon.
Yes. 28.
To dribble up and down the court, just like I'm the king on the microphone. So it's Dr. J and Moses.